Hi, my name is Christopher Ries, and joined with me is my co-founder, Ryan McNutt, and today we're going to be talking to you about how Web3 is going to be a great conduit for building a more financially inclusive future. So the problem essentially is that folks in emerging countries don't have access to traditional financial infrastructure, and we see Web3 as a way to change that paradigm. For context, there are about almost 2 billion folks across the globe that don't have access to critical financial infrastructure like banking and credit. And this is for a number of reasons, but the primary barriers to entry are cost and physical barriers in essence.
So what does infrastructure look like today? Like, what does the current ecosystem look like? There's about 480 million people out of the 1.7 billion that don't have access to banking infrastructure that do have access to internet. And there's a huge push actually recently to give everyone access to internet. About 20 to 30 billion has been invested in from just for Starlink alone. And on the other side for crypto, there is a massive investment in into crypto in general, with over $10 billion being invested in the last quarter of 2021. But this doesn't come without a lot of waste. Shumpitar, one of the head macroeconomists, talked about how with growth, there's a lot of waste. And you can kind of see that in the Terra collapse, and you can see that in the wormhole hack. And this is all like a new frontier. So you can kind of see in the New York ecosystem alone, there are tons and tons of companies that are actually being created. And not all of them will make it, but a lot of them are doing some amazing things. So what does DeFi look like right now? DeFi has gone global. You can see usage across the entire planet, which is pretty cool to see. DeFi is actually, if you looked at it and compared it against all banks, would be the 31st largest bank. And lending is already popular. So Compound is like a super popular platform, and it's kind of leading the way. And stables, which give people in emerging economies access to a more stable dollar, like the US dollar, are already extremely popular.
So we see the ripple effect that Web3 and crypto has on not only business owners, but consumers as well in these emerging countries. And this infographic gives you a better feeling for how business owners prefer blue chip crypto payments, since it allows them to do much more in volume, and they don't have to deal with traditional currency exchanges. Conversely, consumers in these emerging countries enjoy paying in crypto, and they love buying, purchasing goods and services in crypto due to they don't have to deal with the banking restrictions in some of these emerging countries that they'd have to deal with otherwise. They also don't have to deal with the volatility that they'd ensue in their native currencies.
We're trying to undermine the value of your...
So we get this really great picture of the importance of crypto in Web3. And I think this visualization gives you a pretty good understanding of value extracted through crypto in emerging continents like South America and Latin America versus value derived in more developed nations in North America. And you kind of, to put this in perspective, you kind of look at GDP output of maybe South America, which is $4 trillion, versus the United States, which is $26 trillion. And it gives you perspective of how important crypto is in some of these emerging countries. So why is Web3 more inclusive? There are a number of reasons. And we have really great results that show that as crypto and Web3 exist today, is helping transcend some of these race, gender, and age barriers, as we kind of saw in Web2 and prior. And this is for a number of reasons. But the focus on decentralization and privacy gives users some of the same rights that they'd enjoy in Web 2. They get access to new technologies. But they don't have to give up their data ownership and data portability rights. An additional point worth considering is the consensus algorithms, which is kind of how some of these L1s and L2s reach consensus and how they work under the hood, as implemented in common protocols like proof of work, proof of stake, and proof of history, allow these validator node networks to reach consensus without race, gender, and age bias. So there's some great anecdotal evidence about this in folks in specifically in Afghanistan, where people have been deprived of basic financial freedoms. A specific example of this are women in Afghanistan who don't have equal financial rights as men due to Taliban influence in those geopolitical areas. So there's this great story about a nonprofit organization called Code to Inspire. Essentially, they taught 16,000 women about DeFi primitives, like on-ramping and how to use decentralized exchanges. And they essentially gave them the tools they needed to better preserve their wealth in kind of an unstable country and economy. And this gave them a means to leave the country on their own terms in search for a better life. And kind of the last point I wanted to highlight was Web3 is about community. And I think we see this in linear governance models, where everyone's vote matters no matter what.
So kind of where are things headed next? Where do we see stuff going forward? We see a massive move towards like this abstraction layer. So right now, Web3 and crypto in general is extremely complicated. I think everyone kind of knows that. From connecting your wallet to switching networks, it's a pain. And we need an abstracted layer and a better user experience. We also need things to be more in a native environment. So everyone's very familiar with apps like Facebook or Instagram. We don't have any of that right now, really, for a lot of crypto protocols. So we see that as kind of the next thing going forward, so that everyone globally can actually use the system and understand it well. Thank you, and we look forward to the day that Web3 is much more inclusive.